A very good afternoon from wherever you're watching NTV. A warm welcome to this special program where we shall be speaking Parish Development Model Mobilization Campaign in light of government's latest rollout of a plan that is being touted as one that will take Uganda into much needed transformation, as has been espoused and articulated by the president over time. I'm Chris Higenyi, and I'll be joined by the Minister for ICT and National Guidance, Honorable Chris Bariomusi, as well as the Minister of State for Lands, Housing and Urban Development, Ms. Persis Namuganza. Honorables, a very warm welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, and we are glad to be here.
Good.
On NTV.
Yeah, we shall very quickly delve into the discussion. The Parish Development Model Mobilization Campaign. We know there's been a lot of work that is being done behind the scenes in being able to articulate what it means, how it's going to roll out, but most importantly, to be able to involve the grassroots person as embedded in the plan. Mm-hmm. I will begin with the Minister for ICT and National Guidance. You have been at the forefront of pushing this communication and the planning processes. Just take us through what the parish development model is, what it entails, and just how different it is from any other plan that has been rolled out by the government before.
Yes. Thank you very much, and good evening, viewers. The parish development model, people should not get disturbed by this strong English phrase.
Okay.
But basically, it refers to a new programming strategy where government is going to deal with the people at a parish level, a parish being one of the lowest administrative units. Mm. Below a parish, you have a cell. A parish in the Bantu language is a Muruka, at the Muruka level. Mm. Now, this is a deliberate strategy designed by the NRM government. As probably the viewers know, NRM came with a 10-point program, which was revised to 15 points. But when you distill all those points, there are four cardinal ideological pillars on which NRM stands. Mm. If you ask me, what does NRM stand for? We crystallize the ideology of NRM on four pillars. That is the patriotism, pan-Africanism, democracy, and socio-economic transformation. Yeah. Now, this strategy of PDM falls under socio-economic transformation, improving the quality of life of the people. And since the NRM government came, there are many programs which we have championed. Because by the time NRM took over the leadership of this country, we say the state had collapsed. Some of us were old enough to remember how the situation was. There was scarcity of items. The roads were all dead. The country was literally in shambles. So there has been major rehabilitation of the country and an effort to provide services. So we have invested in infrastructure like roads, extending electricity, building schools and having access to education, health centers, extending safe water to communities. All these have been done, but also alongside, we've been bringing programs aimed at creating wealth, aimed at enabling people an income. You recall we have had Ntandikwa scheme, we have had NADS, we have had Operation Wealth Creation, we have had youth livelihood funds, we have had women funds, funds for persons with disability. All of these have been development funds that we send to the districts and local governments for Ugandans to borrow as a revolving fund in order to enable them to have income. Because, yes, we have done infrastructure, but also we've been talking about wealth creation at household and individual level. Now, we have reviewed the performance of all of these programs. They have worked to a great extent, but now we have changed the strategy that we consolidate all these initiatives into one programming strategy, the parish development model, that now we mobilize communities at the parish level in order for the local population to participate in planning and looking at the kind of services that they want, but also most importantly, the element of financial inclusion. So the parish development model, as we've been saying, has seven pillars. The first pillar looks at the production, productivity, value addition, marketing, because our economy is based largely on agriculture and animal husbandry. So you'll find when we promote wealth creation, agriculture takes a big chunk because most of our people are in this area. So that's one pillar. The other pillar is infrastructure. We want people to look at the infrastructure in the community, the roads. If we help in mass production of an item, how do these products reach the markets? We have a pillar on service delivery. We want the local population to look at the health services, education, are the children going to school, and so forth. Then we have a pillar on financial inclusion. Okay, most of the discussion has centered on financial inclusion. Why? I will come back to it, but we are basically saying Uganda has made progress, but we still have a significant proportion of Ugandans and households that still live in subsistence livelihood. Subsistence means this household, they go out, they grow crops, maize, sorghum, yams, potatoes, and they just grow them for consumption. They consume them, but at the end of the day, they don't get any income. Now, why I said the initial programs have succeeded to a great extent is that in the last census, we estimated the households which are under subsistence to be 68% of the households in Uganda. Now, the latest report from UBOS indicates that this number has dropped 39%. So we have 39% of households in Uganda that are in subsistence livelihood. And therefore, that pillar of financial inclusion, because it's the one which is the most talked about, the money we want to extend to villages where we are mobilizing people to make circles. Now, we are focusing on the 39% of the people who live on hand-to-mouth existence. So financial inclusion is one of the key pillars in this PDM. The other pillar is about community mobilization and mindset change, because to liberate people from poverty to a wellness environment, our mindset must change. People should believe that they can do something and create wealth. Then we have a pillar on the management information system. We want to improve documentation. We want to put a monitoring, reporting, and evaluation mechanism so that the program can be monitored well. If there are any setbacks, they are detected early and rectified. Then the other pillar is governance and administration. So those are the seven pillars, but the most prominent one is that one of financial inclusion, where right now we are mobilizing communities at the parish level. You recall the president launched this strategy of PDM on the 26th of February earlier this year. There are many preliminary activities which have been going on. For instance, we have teams on the ground that are collecting data and information from households and individuals, that we profile the communities to know in a parish how many youth are there, what are they doing, what kind of income are the people getting, how do we stratify the population in a parish to see those who are part of the 39%, those who are much better, so that we understand the communities that we are dealing with. We are organizing the people in the parish to form enterprise groups, because we want especially those people who are poor, though the 39%, the subsistence people, to form enterprise groups, to identify enterprises that they can engage in which are profitable. Say women can say, we want to do poultry. Now, can you form a group of women in this parish who would want to do poultry?
To that particular.
And once they form these groups, they now form a circle. These different enterprise groups form a circle at a parish. And this circle will be the vehicle through which government can extend grants, which money will now be borrowed by these households, and the fund will run as a revolving fund.
Okay.
So basically, that's the concept
that's
of the
concept.
Parish, and we are very happy. We've been on the ground. Mm. You have summoned us to come and explain to the public, but the Ugandans have greatly appreciated this strategy, and we are here to mobilize Ugandans to support this cause so that we can fight poverty out of Uganda.
Okay, thank you very much. You will, of course, be breaking down the various aspects of this parish development model as we go on in the next 45 minutes, so to speak. Let me come to the Minister for Lands, said Minister for Lands, Housing and Urban Development. This, in every sense of the word, represents a massive rollout to the various least administrative units within the country. Just give us an overview of the administrative units, the numbers, for example, of parishes that we have in the country, and just how you came as planners within government for this particular rollout, how you decided which parish gets what, and why one that could be perhaps bigger than another gets the same amount of money as one that is smaller. Just take us through that, the blueprint of how you came up with that.
Thank you so much, Chris, and I just want to thank the NTV for this opportunity.
Thank you.
As government, really appreciate when the media come up to really support what we are doing. I'm happy that I'm seated in the middle of two Chris's, and if it was mathematics, they would say that it's Chris squared.
No, now you should become a Christine. Now that you are between the two Chris's.
That's interesting.
You're baptizing me. Otherwise, it's so nice. When I received the information, just like my senior colleague, Dr. Chris Williams, has said, hey, you come, and it's NTV calling. I felt so good. Because as government, we normally push, the minister in charge of ICT knows, we normally push for media houses to give us this opportunity so that people can know out there. You know, we are in the field, as Dr. Chris has said, but when we use NTV, the information reaches mass.
We are glad to amplify that the messages and the campaign.
Dr. Chris has given a preamble of the parish development model. First of all, this parish level of as part of government has been there, and I think it's the second lowest to the village, because the last one is the village level. So we have tried quite a number of programs, just like he narrated, and then we saw that I think we need to go to the low most. Almost least lowest level for us to be able to capture the masses, and they receive the information easily. Of course, when you go to the parish level, you are now almost in the villages, and these villages, of course, they form what the parishes, we are calling the parishes. Like Chris said, this is not new. The program may be new because it's the first time government is sending money to the parish level unit. But the people are familiar with these units. Yes, like you said, the administrative units that we narrate. Of course, you have municipalities, the districts are there, the town councils and all that. But we thought that if we go to the parish level, I think the impact can be bigger.
Yeah.
Of recent, the Minister of Local Government was updating us on the total number of parishes. Dr. Chris, how many are now?
Yeah, 10,000
something.
10,064.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. Yes, and you see that if this 100 million reach each of those parishes, which is going to happen actually, because we have planned that every parish is going to receive 100 million. Why? Because government wants to see the impact it will create. The budgeting and planning is continuous. If we perform well, what stops a parish from receiving a billion? Because we have seen that the administrative unit of the district now has become far away from the people. Our population has increased. Information sometimes does not reach properly on the grassroots. So we thought that the parish is near the people. And we are targeting people who are still in subsistence farming.
Okay.
Chris, I think the people, me, I'm happy that as a person who has been in the field, the people are yearning to work. What are we emphasizing? he has told you about the pillars. But the other issue, the other ideas we are putting forward as government is to advise people on which enterprises are highly earning. Yes, they can have an additional what they want or they have been doing. Like some areas, I was in Usoga and they were telling, we cannot abandon growing a maido. Gina at Sanus, like, no, we are not telling you to abandon a maido. Yeah. We are just simply advising you that government made research on these enterprises like fish farming, beekeeping, piggly and what, and they are highly earning. Yeah. So select some of these because they are well researched as a priority, and then you can have your what addition. Of course, people were lacking such information, and that's why every ministry now is on board. Let it be lands, let it be trade in marketing, as he has told you. We don't want people to produce, the production increases, and then they don't have where to sell their produce, what they have. It will not make sense. Government also, money will also just go like that, because when people produce and they remain with what they have produced. I think that's why the president, you've heard him several times, is emphasizing the market, the regional market, international market, you know, so that we don't just look at Uganda. We are here, we are here. So those are some of the questions which are in the field. Okay. What do we do? Then what we, when we produce, what are, where are we going to sell? Because the people, they have received the message, they have just been yearning to see some support financially, like Dr. Chris said. The financial inclusion is the strongest idea. And remember that this program is replacing the Operation Wealth Creation, where people have been given coffee seedlings, what, piglets, all that kind of thing. Now, we want to take money to them and guide them and to buy quality seeds, assist them where they need professional advice, but let them be involved themselves. Because like you heard His Excellency President say, people were reporting to him that these people, they buy seedlings themselves, it's there, whatever. Even when they distribute amongst themselves. So we have told them to form their own circles, where they know each other. They have selected their own own membership. These members, the treasurer, chairperson, and what, is their members, their own, within themselves. So that for us as government, we oversee and see what they can do. Now that we have given them the authority, the powers to manage the resources, with our guidance, of course, but we want them to handle it themselves, you know, to be in charge.
Okay, we shall come to the aspect of empowerment to when people at the grassroots are given the power, so to speak, to generate own priority areas, but most importantly, the mandate to act on what priorities they're going to put the resources at. It becomes a bit tricky, and we are yet to see how that is going to roll out. The assurances have been made, no doubt, but I'd love you to just, there's something you spoke about, the fact that it's replacing the wealth creation. How about Emioga? Because there's been a series of initiatives that have been undergoing. Emioga, so are we going to see a phase out of Emioga?
No, remain.
Emioga is specialized. These are categories.
Okay.
That I'm doing specifically. I'm doing welding, for example. That is my job. That's what I do. Then you find someone saying I'm a restaurant, whatever. You know, people operator.
Yeah.
Then you find that it's not replacing Emioga. Now, because we want the categorization, the specialization of the talents and what, to remain to in remain. The place.
Okay.
And actually, I'm happy that that is also what people are saying. Now, what do we do? These are the funds, we have removed them. Mioga is not yet phased out because it deals with categories of different categories, people of different talents doing different kind of things, and we would like to support them that way, like the carpenters, you get it. So the PDM mainly is focusing, like Dr. Chris told you, the agriculture, because that is our backbone of the country. Now, when we call it a backbone, how are we supporting
to
it?
To support it.
Yes, so that's why even the mechanization will come in later. Minister of Agriculture has already presented a paper. We are going to bring in the issues of tractors, the Minister of Water, the irrigation. You've heard the president talk about it. We want to support the farmers of different crops, but guided to grow crops that are highly earning. That's why you've been seeing the president repeatedly saying, we want farming which has a chivalo calculation. You know, don't just wake up and like grow rice every day, every year, and there's nothing to you are earning out of this.
Okay, so I think that point is very, it's home. Mm-hmm. No doubt, the other day I was reading about the fact that thousands of tons of wheat were rotting somewhere in Sudan. Yet in Senegal, the president was going to other countries to look out for wheat. So I think when mass production is undertaken, the markets will have to be able to be looked for. However, I would love Ms. Dr. Mariam Munsi to break down the difference in this particular case, the parish revolving fund, how it plays into the SACCOs, and how this whole arrangement is different from the cooperatives that have already been in place. Walk us through that.
Okay, thank you very much. There have also been debates from women, from the youth, that why are you taking away our fund as a youth fund, the youth livelihood fund?
Yeah.
Even yesterday I was having a meeting in Kanungu, and some of the women were saying, why are you mixing us with the rest? You keep our WEP, the money for women.
Yeah.
But like Honorable Pastor has said, we have collapsed most of these funds, women fund, youth fund, Operation Rescue Creation, NADS, all these, into one fund now for the parish development model, except Emyoga, actually I said. That one is going to remain because Emyoga targets categories of people who are in specialized trades. You know, Mwoga is a Chinyankole Chiga word, meaning that if I'm a carpenter, then my Mwoga is a carpentry. If I'm a hairdresser, then my Mwoga is hairdressing. So the way the Mwoga program works is that people who are in a specialized trade, like say carpenters, form a SACCO, an association, and then they are supported by government to expand their business. The hairdressers form an association, and then they access cheap credit from government, and then they can expand. So that one is going to remain. But the other funds are now going to be integrated in the parish development model. And how the revolving fund will work is that, one, like I said earlier on, the people, particularly the people in subsistence, are being organized to form enterprise groups. And there is guidance from the experts in agriculture and animal husbandry. The country has been zoned. There are studies which have been done. So there is guidance from experts on what can do best in which area.
Okay.
For instance, what does best in Kabale and Chigezi may not be what works best in Karamoja. So each area is given guidance to understand what kind of enterprises are profitable and are marketable. And people are forming these groups. Now, after forming these enterprise groups, then they form a SACCO. And then the SACCO will be registered, like other SACCO, the way they are registering. And we want to be clear that people should not pay any money to join an enterprise group, to join a SACCO. Even money for registering these SACCOs is being made by the government. Now, once these SACCOs are ready, then we shall put in money. This current financial year, we had put 17 million shillings per SACCO per parish. But because the parishes were not ready, this money has been saved, and it will be given in July at the beginning of the financial year. I was in Kanungu, I found for them the SACCOs are ready, they have already deposited money.
Which is 2 days from now.
Yes. They have put money on some of the SACCO accounts.
Yeah.
And then beginning next financial year, July, each SACCO at the parish will be receiving 100 million shillings, which we are going to be disbursing in two tranches, 50 million in July, 50 million in January, to target the two seasons. Because like I said, we are mainly looking at agriculture.
Allow me hold you in your trucks so that we can have this very clearly.
Yes.
17 million Uganda shillings and 100 million Uganda shillings.
Yes.
Which comes first? Where?
Uh-huh. Yes, this financial year, which ends on the 30th June, we had already allocated 17 million shillings per parish in Uganda.
Yes.
But because we're still doing the preliminary activities on the ground, forming those enterprise groups, registering the circles, we realized that the parishes were not very ready to absorb this money. So this money has been saved. It will still be given to the circles at the parish level, those circles which have been formed. And then, like we had earlier on said, and indeed we have budgeted for the money, beginning next financial year, each year we shall be giving 100 million. So we have upgraded from 17 now to 100 million. So now, come July, a circle at the parish level will receive 17 million, which has been carried forward from this financial year, and then 50 million. Because the 100, we shall be paying it in two parts. The first half, give 50 million
very quickly.
Then so 50 will be paid in July. So in July, each circle at the parish will receive 17 plus 50, which is 67 million. Then in January, we shall then deposit another 50. Now this money. Now the other Ugandans who are part of these enterprises at the household level, they will be applying for this money as a loan.
Okay.
So from government, money comes as a grant to the parishes because we shall not want that money back. But now you access it as a loan. And we are saying each household can get as much as 1 million shillings to help you do that enterprise. And so you get the 1 million shillings, you invest in poultry or fish farming, whichever enterprise you are in, and then you pay back within 36 months, which are 3 years. And we have put a small interest rate of 6% to just cater for inflation and administrative costs.
Okay, Honorable Minister.
6% means if you get 1 million, in a year you put in 60,000 shillings, which is very affordable. Now, before you switch.
We need to go for a break. There is a lot.
One small point, which is very critical.
Very quickly.
That of the money which goes to the parish, women will get 30% of that money. The youth will get 30%. Persons with disability will get 10%. The older persons will get 10%. And then the rest of us, the men who are in between there, will get 20%. So that's how it will be distributed. Now the argument. The argument that women should keep their fund. I was in the Kanungu and I asked them, how much have we been giving you for women fund?
I'm afraid, Honorable, that point.
I can make it.
That point will be, you'll throw more flesh on it, no doubt, when we return from the break, including a special interest group quarters and the cost, the administrative cost of this particular initiative. Some concerns have been voiced with that regard. Let's now take a break. We shall return, of course, and discuss this further in the next 30 minutes. Do stay with us. You are watching a special program where we're discussing the Parish Development Model Mobilization Campaign. Welcome back. We're glad you're still with us. And if you are just joining us, you're watching a special program where we are discussing the Parish Development Model Mobilization Campaign. Of course, the Parish Development Model, the latest in a series of government initiatives that is aimed at transforming the Ugandan into the kind of citizen that you ought to be. Be able to be do economically well, and of course be part of the transformation in terms of the business that you do. And joining us on the show is the Minister for ICT and National Guidance, Dr. Chris Bariomunsi, as well as the State Minister for Lands, Housing and Urban Development, Honorable Persis Namuganza. There was a bit of a laughter during the break when one person intimated that if they are a woman, they are a youth, and they are disabled, are they going to be tapping from the various baskets? That question goes to you, Honorable Persis Namuganza.
Thank you, Chris. The viewers who are there know that is a very interesting question. Actually, everywhere we passed, most of us, that came up. Because whenever government funds come, there are those people who always, you know, target. Mm. I say, okay. Even the Mioga, they wanted to do it by the way. Mm. When someone say he gets money here and says, no, but I'm not only a carpentry, but I also do this. Mm. But we said, please, stick to one which you need most. So someone was, actually I was in Mayuga and was saying, if I'm a girl, of course I'm still a youth, and I am counted as a woman. Mm. Every girl is a woman, though every woman is not a girl. Can you imagine? Mm-hmm. And I'm disabled. Can't I go and get the disabled money? I also get the youth, and then I go to the female. I will say, no. Okay. That is not allowed. And that's why the Ministry of Gender took the lead of this sensitization, because of the mindset change. Because that means you are not aiming at getting away from subsistence. Mm. Our message has not sunk into your mind. Mm. For you, what you think is that this is a government funds, let me cheat. And then you won't manage. Because if you get from your group, you have joined the parish circle, you are given money, for example, through the group of disabled. These ones are revolving what? Funds. Mm. You need to work and bring back to your own circle, your own, you know, a group. Mm. They will demand that.
To allow for another person within your settings to be able to get the money.
Because your funds will keep increasing.
Yeah.
Because for us as government, we are not giving this problem. And then we withdraw them and bring them back, you know. We want those funds to grow within their circle, within their circle. So they manage you, Chris, and say, hey, Chris, we gave you money to do this. How come you're not even returning anything? Mm. So that is not allowed. Mm. And we are, of course, appealing, sensitizing our people that they should not even think about it. Mm. That means that you are not ready to work hard with government support and get out of poverty. So people who were thinking about that, that's a very lame idea. We don't encourage it. And I think we should focus on working together. Mm. The reason you asked Dr. Chris, and he hinted on it, about these groups, the ministry about cooperative issues. Mm. We want these circles to grow bigger. When they grow bigger, both in number and in what? Funds, because they will keep working.
That's right.
They can now in future form a district cooperative. Mm. That's why the minister in charge of cooperatives is working closely with them, all the certificates and what, and all the training. They have a package within there. What we want to revive in Uganda is the spirit of working together, togetherness. Because people had gone into this dilemma of personalizing, I want to be, you watch the Basoga say, "Kange kachiraka, mine is personal." They don't want to work as a group.
Okay.
And we have seen other countries like China that work as families, as groups. They progress easily. Because they share ideas.
Okay.
Now, when you're working alone, even if a disease attacks your crops, you also take it personal. You find it difficult to consult.
And you finally take the losses.
You finally take the losses by buying wrong drugs and what. That's why in our sensitization message here, the Ministry of Agriculture, because they have production officers there, the districts and what, they will support the parishes. We want them to guide them where to buy the quality seeds, where to buy good drugs, the pesticides and all that, so that they don't buy fake commodities, which will again affect them, and then the money they have goes to waste.
Honorable Bariomosi, that speaks to a mindset challenge where Ugandans have to understand that in order to move forward, in order to become triggers for the kind of transformation that they want, they're going to have to change their way of doing things. Mm-hmm. And perhaps being able to get funds from government or any other person, for example, you should be able to work towards bringing the funds back so that other people can get, especially as the revolving fund is going to operate. Tell us about the mindset change initiative and how it has played out.
Yes, thank you very much. You know, the English say, having a plan without money to implement it is the same as having money without a plan. Mm-hmm. In other words,
they are both alike.
Yes. Mm. Because you can give 10 million shillings to somebody, 2 days
they
later,
no plan.
He has burnt it and he remains in the same condition.
Mm.
So it is important that we tune the mindset of Ugandans for them to believe that even if you are born in a poor background, it is possible to work hard and you transform into somebody who is wealthier. And that is very important, because you go to a community, people are in the same environment, you find somebody has worked hard and prospered in that area, but others are getting worse. So we think that the issue of mindset change is extremely important for people to know that nobody was born or created by God to be poor.
Forever, yes.
That you can get out of that situation. So mindset is extremely important. People even say, when you say, I want capital, I lack capital to do business. Capital, the word capital comes from a Latin word, caput, which means head. So people, it's a little bit derogatory, maybe abusive. People say, when you say you lack capital, it means you lack the head and so forth. So what we are doing now under this community mobilization and mindset change is even a part of what we are doing here now. And that's why we are appreciative of NTV. That we have those different pillars, and different sectors head the pillars. So the Ministry of Gender, Labor and Social Development is the one heading and spearheading the community mobilization and mindset change. So alongside these other interventions, there are teams on the ground that are sensitizing people, that are educating them, particularly those poor people, for them to appreciate that they can work together, they can work hard, they can use the resources at their disposal, like the land and the other facilities. And if they lack access to credit, then that's how the government is coming in with the credit support for them to access this money and use it to transform themselves. And the point that we are making is that if you are to engage in an enterprise, you put in a calculation, as my colleague has said, Chibaro. Don't just dig or cultivate something for the sake of it, because it must be something which can generate profit so that you are able to pay back, then you get a balance, and then
continue with doing
so
business.
The implementation of this program goes alongside massive sensitization, changing the mindsets of our people, especially those at the lowest level of the economic ladder, for them to believe that once assisted, once given a push, once mobilized to work with the others at the community level, they can also get out of poverty. So there is work going on.
There is work going on. Now, many government programs, Honorable Persis Namgaz, have in the past been weighed down by high operational costs. And there is genuine fear out there that this is also going to be, meddled by the cost of implementation alone, so much so that by the time the rollout is done, most of the funds have gone into attending to aspects like the cost of paying the officials. I do understand, for example, that the LC1 has been given a bicycle. The LC3 has a boda to help.
A motorcycle
to help him run around. When you look at 10,694 parishes in the country, a parish has is led by, as Minister for Lands, Housing and Urban Development,
parish chief. Yes.
Now that means that parish chief is more central, like the LC.
Yes.
Those are thousands of bicycles and hundreds of motorcycles. We are already down the drain of high operational costs. How is this being rolled out?
Okay. No, but Chris, the issue is that government is supposed to plan for her people.
Okay.
And Chris, Dr. Chris, when we were beginning, he told you the main, the vision of NLM is to get people out of poverty, and he talks about the economic transformation. So we have been trying for different programs at different levels, and we see it has not worked out. And that's why His Excellency the President came out to mobilize us as cabinet ministers, as members of parliament, now as the public all together, as a country, to try different levels, at different levels, administrative units of government, doing different enterprises which have been researched, supported financially, to see where can we be as a country? So as we budget, all these are budgeted for because we want to yield results. It does not benefit us, Chris, to continue keeping at the level of the district when our people are grappling in poverty and they're not getting out. Despite of the messages and resources being sent down there, our people are still what? In poverty. But also, Dr. Chris highlighted the percentages that each of these person, either disabled or youth or what will be getting. But now we put some money specifically for administration. You see, because if you leave
the administrative cost has been taken care of entirely.
Yes. That's why we are sensitizing the public, the masses.
And how much money
not to allow their money to
administrative costs? Just give us an idea.
No, we are talking of 10%.
No, okay. First of all, one of the reasons where we have shifted from the old programs,
the cost of
to this one, is to reduce the cost of administration because. Women fund, youth fund, what was happening? It was being managed at a district level. The youth have 12 from the village bring their proposal and reaching there, a committee at the district, there were even accusations that a youth group would come, they say, okay, you have been vetted positively, you'll get 12 million shillings, but you sign for 10, such a things. That's why now we are.
Hey.
Yes.
Yeah, there are
the youth livelihood.
Even women fund. That's why now we are saying.
How is that being
addressed?
Taken care of.
Yes, I am now coming.
Yeah.
That's why now we have gone to the parish and put in a mechanism for the local people at the parish to manage these funds themselves. Mm-hmm. How? At the parish level, there's going to be a committee, a parish development committee, chaired by the LC2 chairperson. And then you have the chair of the women council, the chairperson of the youth council, the chairperson is of the council for people with a disability, the chairperson of the council for the elderly, and then the chairperson of the ruling party, NRM, and then the parish chief. These are seven people who constitute the parish development committee. These are the people who will be vetting the proposals that come, the requests from the members of the community. Because they know them. If you come, you Chris, with a proposal, say, but you are putting on suits and you earn a salary, they say, no, you don't qualify. Because they know the people at the parish level. And the only administrative cost that comes in, like I said earlier on, this is going to be a loan somebody gets, and there will be an interest rate of 6%. So that 6% is to cater for inflation and administrative costs. Maybe when somebody goes to cash the money in the bank to bring it for the beneficiary, the transport he or she uses, but there would not be huge costs like buying vehicles. So now me, an MOP, I will do my usual work to do monitoring. The councillors will monitor the way they monitor government programs. The district officials, sub-county officials, will continue doing the usual monitoring without necessarily being given the new vehicles or new offices. No. So the administrative costs will actually substantially get down. Most of the money is going to the people. So the 100 million shillings will go to the circle and it will be accessed by the people. So part of the reason why we went to this parish is to cut off this bureaucracy and also the administrative costs which were involved in the previous programs, which were largely being managed at the district.
You may agree or disagree with me on this, that the average Ugandan is hearing a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And it will be very difficult to disengage the money aspect from them if they can't access it. You know, they are not really looking at, they are not hearing the word decision making and how they are going to be deciding on their priorities. I don't know how is the government ensuring that this is well understood. Of course, the sensitization is there.
Yes.
But at just take us through the process. For example, in Butaleja,
yes,
Kachonga Parish, and then the parish model development model money has come.
Yes.
And then the PDC, that is the Parish Development Committee, has convened. And the people have been told, here we are, this is how it's going to happen. After they've known that they are going to access money, what are they going to be told in the key decision making? Because bottom-up approach means they will be deciding on social priorities, and then government helps out on other things.
No, it will run like this. Right now, the local people are forming those enterprise groups, and it is following guidance from agriculture experts, extension workers, to say, in Kachonga, like you have said, what can work? Maybe poultry can work, fish farming can work, piggery for those who are comfortable with the pig farm, piggery. So they are being guided, and then people are forming their enterprise groups. Now, those groups are the ones which constitute the circle of a parish. Now, when the circle is constituted, the members will elect the executive of the circle, chairperson, treasurer, secretary, and so forth. Then alongside the leadership of the circle, we also have the parish development committee, whose members are already defined by virtue of the position they hold. So what happens now is that when the money comes, it will be put on the account of the circle in a bank, because we have guided that these circles should open accounts in commercial banks, banks which are regulated by Bank of Uganda, like say, and preferably the government banks, like Post Bank, like Housing Finance, where it is, but if not, Centenary and others, or any other big institution regulated by Bank of Uganda. So now, when money comes, now these individuals will apply. They won't apply as groups. The enterprises are for purposes of supporting each other, if you're in the same enterprise. But now people will apply at the household level to the committee.
To the PDC.
The PDC.
Yeah.
Then the PDC will sit and evaluate these applications transparently, because the women are represented there, the youth are there, PWDs are there, the elder are there, the party is also there to look at the interests of the party and so forth. So we expect this process to be extremely transparent. So now, if your application has passed, you say, oh, no, Chris Bugenyi, we give him 1 million shillings. Then a check will now be written. Now this check, the signatories are going to be the chairperson of the circle, the treasurer of the circle, and the parish chief. We have deliberately included the parish chief because these are government funds, and the parish chief is the accounting officer.
Okay.
We don't want money to get lost.
All right.
We put a mechanism, a strong mechanism, to make sure that if you have been given this money, that money should do what you have borrowed for. First of all, the other members of the enterprise will be peers, so there will be peer support and observation.
And monitoring.
But also extension workers, we want to strengthen extension work so that you are supported by extension workers to make sure that if you are engaging in the coffee growing or rearing of chicken, you get technical support from government to make sure that your business can actually be successful.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Chris Bariomusi. I will allow the Honorable Pasis Namganza to have a final word in 30 seconds.
Then the 1 hour is gone.
It's already gone.
Thank you, Chris. This has been good, really. We are, I continue to, and I will, by the way, out there to continue appreciating NTV for inviting us to come and really tell the public what is going on. Of course, people are seeing us in the field there, but when we are here, as at NTV, people are like, oh, they continue to appreciate the program because you media, you play a very big role, either to promote or to bring down. So thank you for being positive. And the people of Busoga, I were with you. We enjoyed our meetings. Please take seriously what we discussed. We shall continue to support the people. I don't want them to look at this program as if government is bringing us up. This
they're
is
embracing it.
They're embracing it positively and do work as usual, but with different guidelines, of course, and advice.
Okay.
We are not forcing them to do what. And lastly, The PDC, this Parish Development Committee, which Dr. Chris is talking about, we are emphasizing everywhere, it's a monitoring committee. That will come and tell us from the lowest unit that this is happening, this has gone wrong, or there is something like this. They are not dictating who gets what, no.
Okay.
So thank you so much for hosting us. And I pray that really God leads this program as we have already prayed as government and cabinet and parliament.
Okay.
And here at NTV, we continue to pray that God helps us and guides us as NLM, and we succeed in this, because I know out there some people may not wish us well.
There's always criticism.
We embrace the program, whether you were opposition, whether you were what, and we help our people to get out of poverty.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Honorable Persis Namganza, State Minister for Lands, Housing and Urban Development. Many thanks to you too, Dr. Chris Bariomunsi, Minister for ICT and National Guidance, for the perspective and, of course, setting straight some of the issues that may be in grey areas in as far as the rollout of the parish development model is concerned. The theme for this discussion has been a parish development model mobilization campaign, and I've been your host, Chris Higenyi. Have yourselves a good evening.